welcome from the Hook of Holland, and also from the Stena Line ferry, the Stena Hollandica, which will shortly be departing for its afternoon voyage to Harwich. Sister ship the Britannica are a familiar sight on the Felixstowe Sea as they make their daily trips to Harwich. They're the largest ferries on the North Sea, and they're designed to take roll-on, roll-off freight, as well as cars and their occupants, and foot passengers coming by train or coach. As the voyage to Holland is 5 to 6 hours, there's accommodation for up to 1,200 passengers in comfortable cabins like this. Although they're not particularly luxurious, they're probably the best ferry cabins for a UK ferry. They have all the facilities you'd expect in your average travel lodge or Premier Inn. In addition, the TV also shows the ship's current position, has a bridge cam, and also a CCTV of the kennels for passengers with dogs. Needless to say, there are all the usual facilities for eating and shopping. Although the Stena ferries are popular with travellers to the Netherlands and Northern Europe, the real bread and butter for these vessels is this: freight. It carries lorries and their drivers, as well as these trailers to be picked up in Harwich. Trailers are big business, and what's here is, in addition to the 2 services a day Stena also do from Harwich to Rotterdam Europort. Ferries are good business for the haven ports generally, with passenger services to Holland and Esbjerg in Denmark from Harwich, as well as freight-only services from Felixstowe, Ipswich and Harwich to Holland and Belgium, as well as to Germany and the Baltic, and even West Africa. The pictures of my voyage on the Hollandica were taken on April 12, 2012. Exactly 100 years ago, on April 12, 1912, the liner Titanic sailed from Southampton on her maiden voyage. We all know what happened to her. In the early hours of April the 15th, the ship went down with a loss of 1,572 people. At the time, it was the largest loss of life at sea for any single vessel. We've all seen the haunting pictures of the wreck, 3,700 metres down on the Atlantic seabed. It was a traumatic event for the nation and the world. As a result of the tragedy, massive changes were made to the design of ships and the rules for safety at sea. You can see evidences of this on modern ships, particularly the lifeboat space for everyone on board. I found the Stena Hollandica and the Titanic interesting comparisons, particularly as they come a century apart. Titanic was the largest moving object in the world back in 1912. By the scale of today's largest ships, she was small. That said, she was a very similar size to the North Sea's largest ferry, that is the Hollandica. She was 46,000 tonnes, 20,000 less than the Hollandica. That said, the Hollandica is slightly shorter and broader, and being a ferry takes half the passenger complement of the Titanic, and most of her internal space is taken up on the 5.5 kilometres of parking space for vehicles. The Hollandica has benefited from 100 years of experience and tragedy, not just learned from the Titanic, but others too, like the Herald of Free Enterprise. It has a full complement of lifeboats, a helicopter pad, a fully drilled staff, and electronic safety and navigational aids. That said, Titanic was intended to be the safest and most luxurious ship of her day. Harland and Wolff, who built her, and White Star Line, who owned her, were proud of their achievement. They had built the largest, fastest, and most advanced ship in the world. One famous phrase that went about in 1912 was that the Titanic was the ship that not even God could sink. A brash statement, but we now know that it was never said by anyone on the management of Harland and Wolff or White Star. It seems to have come from a Titanic crew member trying to reassure a nervous passenger and picked up by the newspapers afterwards. To infer divine intervention in the sinking of the Titanic is wrong. White Star didn't need anything other than their own complacency and incompetence to sink their prized ship. With the wisdom of hindsight, we can see that they just never foresaw what was coming, and a whole series of unfortunate errors and events occurred that contributed to the loss of so many lives. What was worse is there seemed to be very little conception that such a large ship could sink so easily. This led to error of judgment after error of judgment in how the ship was sailed and how the disaster, when it happened, was managed. Captain Smith, who eventually went down with that Titanic, said before the journey started, "I cannot imagine any condition which would cause the ship to founder. I cannot conceive of any vital disaster happening to this vessel. Modern shipbuilding has gone beyond that." If there's anything we've learnt in 100 years, is that it's pretty easy to sink a large ship. They're steel boxes, and all you need to make them sink is to fill them with water. Far larger and better built vessels than the Titanic have met a watery grave. All that's needed is bad seamanship, careless maintenance, poor safety measures, or a war to put tonnage onto the seabed. I said in one of my previous videos that life is a journey. We can also compare it to being a voyage. And in our voyage of life, have we weighed up the risks and costs involved in living our lives in the way we want to? In the Bible, there's a verse that says this: "There's a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death." Now that doesn't sound very cheerful, does it? But think on this. Who would have gone on Titanic if they knew it was going to sink? What the verse is getting at is that if we choose to live our lives without God, then it's all going to end up in disaster. Are we going to be complacent about our life and not factor God into the equation? Or do we think we have it all sussed anyway? God wants us to take life's journey with him, and Jesus opened a way by which we can do that. The decision to take him on board is ours.
Thanks for listening, and God bless you.